Linux is a Unix operating system. Linux is freely available as source code and can also be acquired in many versions in binary form, but these binary distributions always include the source code also. Linux is a child of the internet and runs on everything from IBM mainframes to wristwatches. The core of the Linux system and most of the software that's included with a Linux distribution is licensed as GNU free software. And a Linux system includes a lot of software. This course describes a great deal of the software that comes with Linux, but right now, let me tell you how this all came about. Once upon a time, not too long ago and not so far away, AT&T gave away Unix free to universities. It became part of learning about computers to learn how Unix worked. At that time, Unix was a trademarked name of AT&T. It all began in 1969 on a digital equipment PDP-7. In 1970, it was moved to a larger machine named PDP-11, and it was on the PDP-11 that things really started to take shape. By the way, the name Unix is not an acronym. The originators of Unix had been doing work on a computer manufactured by GE. It was named Multics, and from that they named their tiny system Unix. In fact, some of the fundamental forms, such as the command line options and what have you, that are found in Unix today are very much like the ones in Multics. All of this happened at AT&T's Bell Labs. With AT&T being a tightly regulated monopoly, the government prohibited the sale of Unix for fear of the abuse of the powers of a monopoly. The next big step came in 1974, when Unix was licensed to universities, making it available to students all over the country. During this period, the University of California at Berkeley developed its own version of Unix known as BSD. And BSD also began to make its way around the university campuses. In the 1980s, students graduating from college caused the appearance of a demand for a commercial Unix. A few years later, the first commercial version began to appear. It started spreading and became popular enough for computer companies to specialize in Unix support and Unix software development. Other flavors of Unix began to emerge from other companies. One major version is the Solaris operating system from Sun Microsystems. IBM has a version of Unix named AIX. The one from Hewlett-Packard is named HPUX. Over time, there came to be hundreds of versions of Unix. More recently, the free versions of Unix, such as Linux and FreeBSD, have caused Unix to spread even further. While FreeBSD has been around longer, the Linux operating system has caught on and is constantly expanding into more and more of the computer space in the world. Linux is a Unix operating system originally designed for Intel-based PCs. The original kernel of Linux was implemented as a project started by Linus Torvalds. His original goal was to create a simple system that could be used in place of the commercial operating system, the Unix-like system named Minix. He opened up the source code for development by other parties and posted the whole thing on the internet. The resulting operating system includes software from the Free Software Foundation. In 1984, the GNU project was launched by the Free Software Foundation for the purpose of developing a complete Unix-like operating system. Things didn't go exactly in planned or expected directions, but I suppose that should have been expected with a system being constructed by thousands of programmers scattered all over the world, all working at their own pace and on their own parts of the project. But it certainly got there, and it got there in fine form, and it's still moving on. Development hasn't stopped, and I don't think it ever will. Did you know Unix had a special philosophy? It does. It's not like a mission statement or some formal declaration, and I've heard it described in different ways, but it has been part of all of the Unix systems from the very beginning. The idea is to have small, even tiny, little programs, and have each one of them do exactly one job. You perform complicated tasks by hooking together a group of these simple programs and letting each one of them do its special task. You hook the output from one program directly into the input of another using a built-in mechanism called a pipe. You then put your input into the first program in the list and get your output from the last one. I'll be showing you some examples of how this works a little later on. This tiny program philosophy is just one of the innovations brought about by Unix. You can argue about which of the innovations is the most important, but the basic concepts of dynamically allocating everything was one of the most outstanding. Unix made it very simple for a user or a program to dynamically create and destroy directories and files. It's also very simple for a program to dynamically allocate and free just about any amount of memory it needs. If a program requests more memory than is available, the system begins to swap portions of memory to disk and make more room. All of this is invisible to the individual program because it just gets what it needs. But it isn't really one thing that makes Unix stand out. All of the innovations came from the concept that the designers had about an operating system and how it should work. Most of this stuff we take for granted today, such as files with readable names, collections of things in named directories, the ability to add hardware and device drivers, system configuration files and readable text, and so on. In fact, most of the computing world today is based on Unix. The first operating system for personal computers was called CPM, which was an attempt to implement a very simple version of Unix. DOS was originally written to be a clone of CPM. So if you're familiar with DOS, you already know a lot of stuff you need to know to understand Linux. Okay, that's the really, really brief tour. Next, I'm going to give you a rundown of what's going to be covered in this course, and then we're going to dive right in. Let me mention one very important thing. You are going to have questions. Linux is very large, and I can't nearly cover all of it in this course, but questions will pop up, and they'll need to be answered. Now, I can't answer every question about every application that runs on Linux. There are thousands of them, but anything about Linux itself and anything about the fundamental utility programs of Linux is fair game. Even if you don't have a question, come on over to the forum and see what other people are talking about. If there is anything in this course that you don't understand, that's my fault. So give me a chance to fix it. For some strange reason, I really enjoy answering questions. I guess it makes me feel useful. This is an overview of the things we're going to be covering in this course. Following this movie, we go right into Chapter 2, and Chapter 2 is an introductory look around the file system. There are several lessons that show you how to use Linux utilities to explore and analyze the files in the file system. It's important that you understand the file system. If you install the file system and its files correctly, you have installed Linux. A lot of this course concerns itself with the file system. Chapter 3 continues with the file stuff by exploring the way that Linux addresses devices, such as disk drives. Things known as device nodes match up the right software with the right devices and make things work. It's an automatic set-it-and-forget-it thing. Here in Chapter 4, we're still dealing with a file system. This chapter brings you a little closer to the day-to-day things that you'll be doing to manage your file system. You talk to your computer through a shell. It's the shell that accepts your commands and formats them so the Linux kernel can understand them and obey them. This is all about how you can create your own commands by combining collections of existing commands into a single command. At any given moment in time, there are dozens of programs running in Linux. This chapter is about how to look at them and what they are and why there's so darn many of them anyway. Linux networking is based on TCP/IP, the Internet. In fact, the Internet is built right into the operating system. If you hook two of your computers together to create a LAN, you use exactly the same technology as the Internet, and you can connect your local network to the Internet at large, and everybody can talk. The graphical user interface of Linux is called X, and I'll be showing you how that works. Just about everything you do in a computer involves manipulating files in some way, and Linux has some of the best little file manipulators in the world. This final chapter is for wrapping up some odds and ends that need to be explained, but just didn't come up in any of the previous categories. Okay, that's what's coming up. I'm going to show you how all of this stuff works. When you come right down to it, it really isn't that difficult, but there sure is a lot of it. So let's get started. This lesson is a look into the fundamental structure of the Linux file system. The exact structure, the directory names and locations, will vary a little from one installation to the next, but the things I'll be showing you in this lesson exist in this form on almost all of them. There's nothing magic about the particular names and locations of things, but the names I'm going to show you are traditional. This fundamental naming structure can be traced back to the earliest days of Unix. We're connected to a Linux system through software that's running on an MS Windows system. This is the free software named Cygnus that can be used to emulate an X terminal. All the graphical user interfaces used on Linux are based on X, also known as X11, which makes it a relatively simple matter to connect external graphics terminals. In fact, the fundamental structure of Linux is such that several terminals of different types can all be connected at once. But I'm getting ahead of myself. In later lessons, we'll be exploring the X Windows system and how it works in some detail. And we'll be coming back to the Cygnus software being shown here, and you'll see how it all goes about displaying Windows from programs running on a Linux system, or even Windows from several Linux systems all at once. This is a terminal window, and this is the form of my personal command line prompt. I'll be showing you how to set up your own prompt later. I use this form because it helps me keep track of where I am. Now this prompt shows that this window is currently logged into a system named Arlen, and that the current login is Arthur. The current directory is my home directory on that system. I have found this information to be particularly useful when I'm networked with computers being able to connect together this way. More about all this later. Right now, let's take a look at the file structure of this Linux system. All of the files on a Linux system are to be found inside the directories and subdirectories of the root directory. This one directory includes as subdirectories all of the separate partitions on a disk drive as well as all of the other disk drives, including CD-ROMs and floppies, everything. Even the file systems of other computers can be mounted inside this file system as a directory. It's all under the umbrella of the root directory, which is simply named slash. The command named ls can be used to list the names of the files and directories in the current directory. The current directory is now the root directory, so let's take a look at what's here. These are the directories created by the installation of Red Hat Linux, and these directory names are fairly standard for all Linux distributions. I have doctored my ls command a little bit so it always indicates directory names by putting a slash at the end of the name. This doctoring of commands is done with a facility called alias, and we'll be getting into that a bit later also. Although this file system appears to reside on a single disk drive, that's not necessarily the case. Other disk drives can be added and mounted so they appear as directories. I happen to know that the directories you see here named boot and home are on different disk drives, and I'll be going into that in a bit more detail later. In the next lesson, we'll be taking a look at the content of these directories.